So, will this jacket actually make you James Bond?
Maybe not.
Okay, but can you pull off James Bond's jacket? I think you can. Despite being worn by a soldier for Queen Elizabeth, this is not an unrealistically tactical or military-like jacket. In fact, it's also worn by Ryan Reynolds in The Adam Project. Boyd Holbrook wears a modified version of it in Predator. Ian Ziering has one in Sharknado 4. You may have noticed we're listing films in descending order of their quality here, but the main downsides of this very famous jacket is not everyone likes this random buttonless hole here, which they actually covered up when James McAvoy wore the gray version of this in Split. And not everyone likes the fit, which is definitely the most controversial aspect of this and why I got two sizes of it for this video that I'm gonna show you later. My name's Nick, by the way, and this is Stridewise, where we look at men's boots and high-end casual wear, and this is the Rogue Territory Supply Jacket Review. I've worn this jacket from Manhattan to Mexico, and we're going to cover the look, the material, the fit, the price, and the pros and cons so you can make the right choice for you and this jacket that everyone will not stop talking about. Even before we all knew that Daniel Craig sports it in No Time to Die, I think it was already the coolest and most celebrated wax jacket in the United States. Yes, Barber and Bellstaff have their very famous wax jackets, but they're British, they're more expensive, and I don't think they're cool. Like, those are not cool jackets, I'm sorry. They're boxy, they're long, they're designed for rich people hunting foxes and look like it, and they're so waxed that they permanently look like they're dripping wet. There, I said it, I don't like British wax jackets, and neither it appears just James Bond. Okay, so this is the supplied jacket in tan ridgeline from Rogue Territory, a heritage apparel company. And if you haven't heard that term before, heritage fashion is modeled after or inspired by clothes that Americans used to wear for work or outdoor activities like about 100 years ago. So it's clothing and footwear that are made with traditional, natural materials that are tough, thick, and have a lot of longevity. We used to buy clothes that were intended to last a long, long time, and heritage fashion is animated by that ethos. And very importantly, heritage stuff looks better as it ages. So classic examples are thick leather boots, chambray work shirts, selvedge jeans, and waxed canvas. And heritage stuff is usually made in America or Japan because a lot of craftsmen in Japan preserved and perfected these old-fashioned ways of making clothes. So then you get this jacket. So canvas is very densely woven cotton, and waxed canvas is a material that began when sailors noticed their sails caught more wind when they were wet. And so to mimic that effect when it wasn't raining and to make sails less porous, they waxed the canvas, which had the added benefit of making rain roll right off of it. Eventually, this strategy of waterproofing extended to jackets and tents and bags, and especially when it's waxed, canvas looks really cool as it ages, and a lot of people sell old canvas bags and sometimes jackets at a profit because people just love the way they age so much. Canvas is also super resistant to abrasion and tears, and in some ways it's better than leather. I tore an old leather jacket open on a nail and it could not be repaired. That doesn't happen to canvas. It's designed to withstand thorns and snags and stuff. The thickness and toughness of canvas is measured by its weight per square yard. So like a pair of jeans, denim is twill, not canvas, but like whatever. Most modern jeans are 11 or 12 ounces. This jacket is 10 ounces. It's not crazy heavy. There are some legendary wax jackets out there that are over 20 ounces. We've reviewed one before. I own a 25 ounce unwaxed jacket. This one's fairly lightweight, but what that mostly means is that it's a good weight for spring and fall, and that it provides durability and water resistance without being too hard to break in or too restrictive with your ability to move. So the weight has its pros and cons, but honestly, it's mostly pros. Note that this jacket comes in a lot of other colors as well, and other heritage-y materials as well, like shashiko, unwaxed selvedge canvas, twill, and more. The design, meanwhile, is super minimalist, and I just love it. It's just two hand warmer pockets, a very slim welt pocket on the left chest that's really only good for a phone or a wallet. Even then, it's not that great at holding a phone. You can see the phone here, right? There's also a little interior pocket on the right chest. This is about the same size as the pocket here. That's pretty much all the jacket has for features. It is unlined as well. It's like it's just the canvas. If that disappoints you, Rogue Territory does sell a version that's lined with Japanese wool for an extra $100. But the classic supply jacket I'm wearing here is unlined. When this is buttoned up, people regularly tell me that I've missed a button where I didn't. because it's designed with a random hole right here that throws a lot of people off. I understand it's a callback to when men wore pocket watches and the watch chain would like run through here, but most people will see it as an orphaned buttonhole and plenty of people don't like it. And the other downside is the fit, which is very slim. Now, a lot of wax jackets like the ones you'll find at Filson have a looser and boxier fit designed for work, which not everyone likes. Like that kind of fit isn't considered super modern or fashionable. Rogue Territories is more of a trucker jacket fit, meaning it's short and slim. Truckers don't have to like swing their arms around a whole lot when they're working after all. This also makes it pretty unforgiving on huskier body types. So larger guys may want to avoid this jacket, unless you're comfortable getting like a size up that'll be too big on the arms and shoulders in order for you to be able to button it up around the torso. Or if you're like my mate Ben Curry, he actually asked Rogue Territory to send him some extra canvas so that he could insert new panels under the arms so that it could fit his body. Most guys will not have the patience to do that, but that is the length you'll have to go to if you aren't an especially slim guy and want the jacket to fit you well. Truthfully for me, I don't like buttoning my supply jacket up. I've done it here. As you can see, if I'm standing with like good posture, it does pull apart a little bit here. And to show what I mean, I took the liberty of getting two supply jackets. Now, I'm 6 feet tall, 190 pounds, and I recently measured my chest with a tailor who put my chest at 44.5 inches. Rogue Territory puts their large at 43 inches, and usually I'm a 42 or 43 in clothing because brands usually do vanity sizing. Now, this large, I think it looks pretty good on me. It's as slim as I'm comfortable with. If it were a millimeter smaller, I'd hate it. I don't think it looks that great buttoned up. Like the buttons are pulling apart. It's just a little bit too slim on me. And I do obsess over my clothes. So to put my mind at ease, I also got the XL. And this is the XL, which has a 45 inch chest according to the company's measurements. It looks better buttoned up, yes, in that it doesn't pull apart so much at the chest, but it's also boxier around my waist and it's a lot longer on the arms. I think it just looks too big. So you see me in the large and the extra large. I took out my own tape measure and like armpit to armpit, I put the large at 21 and a half inches and the XL at a little under 22 and a half inches. Now, depending on your own like kind of personal style, it's possible that you would have preferred getting the XL size, right? If you were me, you would have rather have the XL size. Even though it's kind of like long on the wrists and everything, it does fit better around the chest and looks better buttoned up. For me personally, I continued wearing the large with the understanding that this is a bit like a leather jacket. It looks better unbuttoned and I don't really plan to button it up anyway. That's my approach to it, right? Like, I guess I should mention I lift weights a bit so my torso is a little more V-shaped than average. If yours is more straight up and down, you probably won't have a problem with like the buttons around the chest pulling apart, right? But if you've got a bit of a chest, honestly, I say leave it unbuttoned and just take that as punishment for all that time you spent in the gym instead of at church. One last thing I want to say about the fit and the design is that a big upside of this slimmer, modern fit and minimalist look is that this is very easy to dress down and not that hard to dress up. Like, it's not dressy exactly, but I've worn this with a button down and slim jeans to a nice dinner and it doesn't look stupid. Most wax jackets like Tom Beckby or Flint and Tinder are hard casual, which isn't a bad thing. Like, this is the kind of fabric that's typically considered casual but high quality, like elevated casual, I suppose. The supply jacket's combinations of slim fit and collar and buttons, like not like flappy pockets or anything like that, like nice like slim hand-worn pockets. All that means that it's not that crazy to wear this out on the town, and there are a lot of other much more casual wax jackets that you'd feel a bit weird doing that in. But all right, the price is $295 right now, and look man, there are two things to keep in mind here when talking about the price. Number one, given James Bond drives $300,000 cars and wears $1,000 shoes, that's not bad. It's gotta be less than you were expecting, right? Now, it is unlined 10 ounce canvas, yeah, but like number two, for a jacket that's made in America from wax canvas, it's actually not that bad, like relative to that whole industry. You do need to understand that much of what you're paying for here is the design and the coolness, sure, but I've got an article in the description below about the best wax jackets on the market. Check that out, you'll see made in America and under $300 and made of wax canvas is actually pretty rare. Like it is unlined, yeah, but nonetheless, if this is a look that you want, this is actually very far from the highest price you'll find. So to wrap up the pros and cons, the pros are it's very durable. Canvas is great, it lasts forever, it's mad super tough. It'll age really beautifully as well. It's also water resistant, it'll keep you dry. It's a very modern fit. Heritage jackets and heritage fashion usually aren't modern and form-fitting. So there are a lot of guys like me who like heritage materials, but prefer modern fits. And that usually means I have to settle for Chinese made brands like Tailor Stitch. So in that way, this jacket is a nice introduction to heritage stuff. It makes it more palatable for a modern audience. It also comes in a ton of colors and materials. I think the price really isn't that bad. You might disagree, but again, I've looked around the industry. I encourage you to as well. And remember what I said about it being more resistant to tearing than my leather jacket. Like, canvas is a long-lasting, durable material. And again, some arguments to say that it's better than leather in some respects. For a wax jacket, it really bears emphasizing that it's probably the dressiest wax jacket you'll find as well. Like the slim button fit, the simple collar and buttons. If not dressy, the easiest to dress up wax jacket, I think. Oh, also, James Bond wears it. Downsides are this pocket watch hole here is weird. It's a part of the brand, it makes it recognizable, but to most people it's just weird and looks like you missed a button. There aren't many pockets. That doesn't usually bug me, but there's nowhere really to put your phone so it's unseen. Like, it's at risk of falling out of the hand warmer pocket, and it doesn't really fit in this chest pocket here. You can slip it inside this one, but then when it's buttoned up, like it's very clearly sticking out of your chest. You know what I mean? That's a downside of the slimness and the minimalist design. Wax canvas doesn't breathe very well. That is kind of the point of it, is that it's not porous, you know, so it can be more water resistant. Just know that if it's even a little bit warm out, this jacket becomes really not fun to wear. Also, the wax eventually wears away on wax canvas and you're meant to reapply it when that happens. If you do, it looks cooler and is more waterproof. If you don't, it'll breathe better, so make your choice. And lastly, the fit is unforgiving. I'm sure it inspires a lot of guys to lose weight, and I guess that could make the fit a good thing for the world. But yeah, there are a lot of buddies it won't fit. But I think life gets a lot better when you actively decide to make it a jacket you don't button up. Like, you'll be happier if you accept that as a possibility when you order it. Some of the best fitting leather jackets out there can't really be buttoned up either, and everyone's fine with that. So just have that approach here. All right, man, that is my year-long review, I think, of the Rogue Territory Wax Jacket. It's really, really cool. It's currently my favorite one to wear, like, out on the town. It's the one that blends the most easily and fashionably into modern life, you know what I mean? So I think it's a really nice, very, very versatile jacket, and the price isn't too bad either. I'm a big fan of it. There's a link to get it in the description below if you want, and also you can check out all the other kinds, all the other materials the jacket comes in as well. That's my whole review. Make sure you subscribe as well, man, because I got a lot more stuff on like heritage fashion if you're kind of interested in that stuff, like boots, salvaged denim, leather jackets, bags, all that kind of stuff coming up.
No, it's not good. Am I saying something? Maybe not.